might make sense to ask Fred if he would go next to talk, give us a little bit more of a 101 about the testing approach, since you have a long history with the Department of Education on this.
Okay, good evening. Assembly Member Simon asked me to talk about concepts that are essential to all examinations, including the SHSAT. But first I have to confess something to you. I took the test for Bronx Science 60 years ago. When results came out, I was told I made the waiting list. I'm still waiting. So I wanted to make some bullet points. Okay, thank you. First, you should realize that tests are just a sample, they're just a snapshot. To be useful, they must be reliable, but there's always a degree of uncertainty about every test score. This is known as the error of measurement. But for a test to be valid, it must be go beyond reliability, and there needs to be evidence that it fulfills its purpose. The aim of the specialized high school admissions test is to screen applicants and identify those who are likely to do well in one of the eight schools. Publishers and agencies are also expected to meet professional standards that require essential information from them about the nature and proper use of their exams, so reviewers can assess whether they are functioning adequately. Let's look at these points. Samples. When eighth grade students take the SHSAT, they must answer a limited number of questions covering English language, arts, and math. The sample of items changes from year to year. The aim is to screen applicants for admission and identify which are good bets to succeed academically in one of the specialized high schools the following year. Now let's look under the hood of the program. Okay. I just found this out in studying for this presentation. That the test has 94 items. 47 in math and 47 in English. Students have 3 hours to complete the test. I didn't know this, but did you know that several forms of the test are given to applicants each year? In October, the test was taken by about 28,000 out of 80,000 eighth graders. And students may choose from 1 to 8 schools and must indicate their preference order. After the exam, the scores of all applicants are arranged from highest to lowest. The student with the highest score is placed in his first or her first choice. Selection proceeds from the top score down. Each applicant is placed in his or her highest listed school where seats are available. If all seats are filled, the applicant is offered the second choice, etc. And the results are due in March, and they may be delayed a bit this year because there is some court action involved. Now I'm going to talk about reliability. No test is perfectly accurate. No measure is perfectly accurate. But for any test to have value, the results on it must be consistent or stable over time. Measures of physical attributes such as height are quite reliable. educational tests do not reach such a high level of precision, but test makers strive to reach that point. There are formulas for estimating how reliable the test is. These calculations are significant because they lead us to an understanding that each score on a test is not a single point on a scale, but rather a number falling within a certain range. And that realization tells us that there is imprecision inherent in any score and cautions us not to overinterpret how an individual performs on a particular test at a single moment in time. The more reliable the test, the lower the error of measurement. Now, these are factors that could affect somebody's performance on a given day when they take the test. These are the kind of things that arise that raise questions about if I'm a student and I just missed getting into the school of my choice, maybe if I had taken the test on a different day, I might have done well. Maybe I would have taken a different form. Maybe I would have guessed, they're all multiple choice items. Maybe I would have guessed one more item. Every point counts, remember. The determination of where you go depends on how high you score on the test. So there are a lot of factors. The items change from year to year. How the applicant feels on a given day might affect the score. You can imagine yourself some of these variables that could change the balance. And since a test, if it's used in a rigid way, since it's done that way, any one point counts. That's why I'm still waiting. Now, then there comes up the question of validity. That's the jackpot question. Even if the test is reliable, we are left with the overriding question about its validity. Is the test doing what it's supposed to do? What do the scores mean? Is there a better way to do it? What are the limitations on the kind of judgments that can be reached based on the results? In the case of the SHSAT, we want to know if it has predictive validity. If an applicant is accepted to a school, has his or her ability to succeed been properly assessed? On the other hand, if students score close to the cutoff and are rejected, are these false negatives? Would they have done well had they gained acceptance to their chosen school? What do we know about those who came close but didn't get in? A central question is, what criteria are we trying to predict? Is it freshman averages in high school? Grade point averages, ranking after 4 years? On-time graduation rate? SAT scores, which enter into the college selection? The highest level of education they will attain, successful careers and income level after college, personal satisfaction in life. These are all potential things that are out there as criteria, but they vary, of course, from short term to long term. As we know, New York City is the only public school system in the country that bases admission to its finest high schools on a single test score. And we must ask ourselves the question, is there better ways to predict how students will do? Many colleges now have stepped away, for example, from using the SAT scores or giving them controlling influence in making admissions decisions. The selection process as colleges has been based on a model that takes into consideration skills other than the ability to pass verbal and numerical exams. Instead, admissions officers interview students, look at their essays, strengths in other subjects, interests, participation, and activities. In other words, they build a picture of the applicant, maybe a portfolio That gives them a more complete picture of the applicant. In effect, it gives them a bigger sample to go on in making a judge decision about each applicant. Final point, I'm sorry, drawn out a bit, but every test maker and every test user is responsible for providing information about their instruments, about their tests. That's a professional standard. Too often, that standard is not upheld. And I think the public and the parents should know that in the absence of such information, our discussion becomes one more of heat than light. So I would urge us to come away from this pressing for full disclosure on this. This test, there's been very limited information. I know Dr. Taylor will speak more about what he's done, and I apologize for going over my time with it.
Thank you. Thank you.